some environmental groups were giving, and they pointed out the situation of the salmon very accurately, but then said the dams will likely never be breached because of their economic output and value to you know, Washington and Eastern Washington. And I heard that, and I went, oh, wait a minute. They didn't read this report. And so had they read it, you know, it's pretty clear that there's an economic issue with these dams, and I'll get into that. But anyway, I happened to stand up, and I said something in front of about 400 people, got caught on camera, ended up on a documentary called Damnation, and then after that started screening, I just decided I better, you know, get my head back into the game there and figure out why I was so concerned back in those days, because we had some real concerns about this study. So there's a lot of political pressure to get it out and get and come up with the right answer, if you know what I mean. And so out it went, and we kept the dams. And I'll talk more about what that meant. Anyway, I spent a ton of hours trying to decipher all these reports, the thousands of pages of stuff and so forth. And I don't work for anybody, don't belong to any represent any organizations. You'll see Dam Sense referenced, and a lot of people think that's an organization. It's actually not. It's just a website where myself and other volunteers and some compensated consultants and stuff post information, reports and letters, etc. Some of our volunteers are actually still in the government. Some of them still work at Walla Walla, and they're very, very helpful. And what they do is they, you know, make sure we don't, you know, incorrectly state something. And they also point us to the information, which, by the way, we make a point to use public domain data only. And so about 95% is public domain. The other is we get through a FOIA request. And the one reason I like doing that is because I'm going to show people that you don't have to be inside the government to see this information and use this information and do something with it. And so that's why we stick to the public domain stuff. It mentions the 2002 Lower Snake Feasibility Study, EIS. This is a key document. This has tons of information. And as I mentioned, there's some of the individuals helping out on this are from different parts of the government and tribes and states. And they also help and write some of the key reports. In fact, we wrote a supplemental breach plan to the EIS to get it updated, since some people say this is old. But anyway, that's who the background sources are of our team. Let me start with some of the overarching economic costs and cost drivers. And I use the term economics and cost. It's really, there are two fields of study. You know, there's cost engineering and cost analysis, and there's the economic work that economists generally do. And they're both used by the Corps of Engineers, of course, but I'll try to distinguish when I'm talking about economic value versus an actual cost. First off, the four Lower Snake River dams were never economically viable. Back in the 1920s, when they researched this stuff, you know, people wanted inland navigation up to Lewis and Idaho. It never penciled out. In 1945, they added hydropower to the equation. It still didn't pencil out. You know, pencil out means it's got to have a benefit greater than one, which means the cost have to be below the benefits, okay? And so in 1947, though, they tried again. And once again, the BCR came out 0.87, still below one. But they got clever, and they introduced some interesting, very creative benefits that are, by today's standards for the last 30 years, are forbidden. In other words, it's improper economic benefits. But they added those benefits, and you can read it right in the report, how they put those in there and said, if we added this, we'd get a good BCR. So it was signed off by the district commander, and off it went, and here you got four Snake River dams. Now, the BCR today is based on what the Corps studied, and when you look at it properly and put it into a correct format for this kind of analysis, it's still below one. In fact, it's way below one. And we found that the Corps, when they looked at the BCR for breaching, and we've updated that information and done some corrections based on the Corps data, the BCR ranges from 4 to 1 to 19 to 1. And it all depends on the hydropower, because that's the big gorilla on these projects. Their 92% of their purpose is hydropower. And I'll talk about why there's an issue about that. Do we need to replace the power? If you need to replace it, the benefit is 4 to 1. If you don't, it's almost 20 to 1. Now, the cost, the full-out cost of the tax and ratepayers appear to be exceeding revenues. And now I'm basically saying, on an annual basis, how much money goes into those dams and how much revenue comes off the dams. And what we're seeing now is that over the last 5 years, cost have exceeded revenues. And I'll show you a little bit more in detail. And that's part of what, I don't know if you know this, but do you guys realize that Bonneville Power is said they're in dire financial situation or strength? You heard that? Well, get ready for that, because you're going to see your rates start going up more than they've been going up historically. The Corps spent $1 billion on passage improvements through a program called the Columbia River Fish Mitigation Program. And that was a result of the EIS. Some money had been spent in that program over 4 or 5 years earlier, another $200 or $300 million. But just since this EIS was signed, another $1 billion has been spent on passage improvements. And guess what you got for your money? No passage. There really isn't any improvements. I want to jump down to one thing. This is a chart that's put out by the Columbia Research Service, part of the University of Washington. And this is data from the Corps of Engineers. And what it does, it looks at counts of fish over the dams that are using, that have pit tags in them. And I think most of you guys know what that is. They put a little chip inside some of the fish. And they can then track them going down and when they come back as adults. And here's the problem. This is a smolt to adult ratio kind of return. And the scientists, the fish biologists, tell us that you have to have returns. Let me see if I can use this to show you guys. If you need to have returns at least over 2%, because you can't recover if you're not over 2% in terms of this average, this survival ratio. And ideally, you've got to be over 4%. That's how you really start getting recovery. But the minimum is, if you're not making 2%, you're in real trouble. And what you can see here is that, except for 1 year here in the last, a little bit here, but over the last years, we've been below 2% and down here below 1%. And if you're below 1%, you're basically heading toward virtual extinction. Now, I wouldn't say extinction because, salmon are really tough critters, and you'll probably always have a handful of remnant population someplace. And so, but virtually they are. And that means you just basically, there are a handful of fish left. And you can see that over the last few years, last 4 years, we're really tanking out to the bottom. And this is fish over Lower Granite. Lower Granite is really important because if the Chinook get above Lower Granite, then they move into Idaho and a lot of great habitat that's up there. Problem is, we've got great habitat, and BPA and the Corps spend a lot of money on habitat, and we've got no fish making it back. So this is the problem with that $1 billion investment. Okay, so what are some of the costs in terms of the dam operations and for maintenance and rehabilitations and everything? There are basically six categories that we use in the economic analysis. And these numbers we've based on actuals that two things are based on is when the Corps did this report, they projected cost out 100 years. And we found that some of those costs were pretty okay. There's other ones we knew were low, and we've had different people, engineers, review those costs and correct them. And so now, as we look at what is being spent in 2017, and this is, some of this is on actuals, and some of it is based on projections, because we didn't have publicly available information to actually use. But what it looks like right now is the Corps' operations and maintenance money on the four dams is about $42 million last year. And we just saw down at Ice Harbor a little chart that said $11 million on Ice Harbor. So that kind of adds up. You got four dams, you get to 40 pretty quick. The turbine rehabs that are going on at Ice Harbor, this shows $18 million a year. Now, that's actually a $110 million project. And so that $18 million, and it's scattered over a whole, like 8 or 10 years almost. That is still going on. Just got a little update on it, so it sounds like we're making progress there, but it's still a cost item. You'll notice that I say in some of these BPA debt and BPA funded, If BPA funded means it's given, the Corps is given, BPA has given the Corps a check to do that work. If it's BPA debt, that means the Corps of Engineers took your tax money, paid for it, and it basically it comes a debt that BPA has to pay back. And they have to pay back 92%. So anyway, then Power Services is the bondholder's equivalent of O&M, and that's about 37. So you can see right off the bat, we've got, you know, 70, 80 million going into operations and maintenance on four dams. The systems improvement so that is that $1 billion, Columbia River Fish Mitigation, and last year we spent 30 million. Most of that was up on the upper dam, Lord Granite, for the fish bypass system that is unfortunately not panning out very well. The compensation plan hatcheries were put in place to mitigate for the Snake River dams. They were built by the Corps. They're now EPA funded for operations and maintenance and repair. They're about 33. Conveyance dredging is up at Lewiston. And there's two kind of dredging they do up there. One is navigation to get the barges up to Lewiston. And imagine that the navigation channel is about this big. Conveyance channel dredging is about this big. And conveyance dredge is to remove sediment that's dropping out in the river up there. Over 100 million cubic yards at Lewiston. And if you don't take that out and it keeps building up, when you have a flood, what you do is you create a backwater effect and it overtops the levees in Lewiston. Corps has not done any of that conveyance dredging since 1997, but we still show it as a cost because obviously if you have a problem up there, somebody's got some big bills to pay. And this is one of these, this next one is NREX. This is a new kind of category of money that Bonneville Power has developed, and basically that's non-recurring exceptional maintenance or something. It's kind of one of those things you can't figure out exactly what it is, but we know how much it is. And it's a sort of an O&M expense that they don't have O&M money, so they call it something else, is accounting. So we're running about $182 million. But then if you add the interest and the service, debt service on that interest, means you're borrowing money to pay the interest payments. So that's kind of like using one credit card to pay for another one. So Bonneville Power is doing that, and that's about $45 million. So we've got $227 million in cost. Power revenues, according to Walla Walla District, are running about $200 million a year. So, okay, that loss is about $27 million. That's what we've been seeing over the last 4 or 5 years. I showed you that. So this is the economics. And what that means, we take all those costs, we spread them over 100 years, and we, you know, do all the escalations and put in the rehabs and all that kind of stuff. And basically what it comes out to in terms of an economic comparison between keeping the dams and removing the dams is if you keep it, it's like 15 cents on the dollar. That's a problem for the Corps. And it's somewhere between $4 and $20 a benefit if you remove the dams. Again, the big difference is that power. And I'll show you some charts about why we don't, it's not we, it's why the numbers show you do not need to replace that power. And I have a handout that I'm going to give you guys maybe, you know, when I finish speaking, because it might we have some questions. But it's the rest of this thing, and you can take it, and you can, and I'll just go ahead and pass it out now. And you can take some there and some there. That might be enough. And those cover all the different economic features of the hydropower, transportation, irrigation, recreation, and all this kind of stuff. Now one thing, you're going to see some really high numbers in there. And that's because economists use these very sophisticated comparisons of money, like a 1 point billion for recreation. That's not necessarily a real dollar amount that you would see out on the ground. But I'll show you what you are going to see out on the ground in terms of economic benefit. But they're used to compare alternatives in the Corps, and that's the standard procedure the Corps uses. We followed the process to the T and made sure that the Corps documents were correctly, in other words, the data in the core documents was correctly analyzed and portrayed. Now, does any of you guys know who this fellow is? Well, his name's there. Elliot is the, he's your administrator of the Bonneville Power Administration, okay? Federal employee. And I want you to, this is, he's making a statement last March to the Northwest Power and Conservation Council. And they're sort of the governor's oversight group for Bonneville Power, kind of telling them, you know, what are you guys doing? Are you doing the right thing? And so he hasn't briefed them for a long time, maybe it was a couple of years. So anyway, listen to what he's got to say about, listen to what he's got to say about BPA's financial situation.
To be really frank, you know, if there's an axis of sort of nonchalance to panic, you know, I think it's important that we don't get into a panic mode. I'm not in a panic mode, but I'm in a very, very significant sense of urgency mode, and I do think that the risks facing Bonneville are real. And I feel that even though we have 10 years left in our long-term contracts until 2028, that the time for action, and I think real action, is now.
Okay, so there's a top guy in BPA. He's telling us we got a problem. And I don't know about you guys, but you say you're not ready to panic, but you're pretty close. Well, I would take that serious. What was striking about this, that might be one of the most important statements coming out of somebody's mouth in the Pacific Northwest in the last 20 years, because this has profound effects for our Bonneville Power Administration, our dams. And so we're going to dig into this a little bit more, but and the other thing, he mentioned power contracts, 10 years. We've got 10 years. Well, that's the public utility districts signed 10-year contracts back in 2008. Or maybe earlier, but anyway, there's 10 years left on them. But I'm going to show you, well, let me just show you this chart next to point out that those contracts are in real contention right now, because this chart from BPA's strategic plan right here that came out, he's briefing this plan. This chart is in there. And what it shows is that BPA's cost and what they charge for these lights, and to you as ratepayer, is up here, 2018, is about $37 or whatever a megawatt hour, okay? Now, and so that's those contracts. But if you go out on the open market, and you can see the trend here, in 2018, there basically is a $10 or $12 difference. And so industries that are allowed to move, you know, buy power easier, like a factory, they're walking away from BPA, and they're losing customers. And so the PUDs are getting really nervous here, because their rates continue to go up. Audible, you know, in my PUD went up 4.8% this past year. And then we're going to get hit with a 2% surcharge again this year because they're out of cash. So this is a really bad business model profile, or whatever you want to call it. Some of you guys are business majors. This is not good to be, because there's a lot of customers that can go out and get power here, and they're trying to do it. And I think that PUDs will start breaking away from these contracts and walking, like the aluminum industry did back in 1999. This red dot up here is about what we think the cost is of per megawatt hour of the Snake River dams. And so you can see that they're one of the more expensive dams in the system. Part of the reason is they have such low flows that they are not running turbines, right now look pretty good. Of course, you're spilling a lot, but what, two or three turbines, but in July and August, you might be down to one for about a month, then two for a couple of months. And so the problem is the Snake River dams is constrained flows. Now, in springtime, you got massive flows, and so you might have, unless it's one of them broken, you'll have all the turbines running. And the problem is, at that time of year, you'll have prices. And this is an actual price we saw in April. And that it's actually, we've seen that number, minus 22. You know what minus price means? That means we're paying California to take power at $22, or $16 in this case, a megawatt hour. So that can ruin you pretty quick. Quantico has burned through $600 million worth of their cash in the last 3 years. They basically are down to, I'm getting ahead of my chart. I'll come back to the cash reserves. Now, one of the things we found is that, you know, there's a lot of surplus power, and we had a power economist go back through all the production hours on the Snake River Dams, 93, in fact, it's 96,000 now, and what he found was that it was only 2 hours of that 96,000 that was actually needed by a BPA customer. The rest was sold in the open market at a loss, or in most cases a loss, except, you know, maybe in the summertime if they have some, but when you average it all out, it's being sold as a loss. And last year, we saw a lot of wind curtailments. You know, what that means is that they basically had to shut down wind turbines. And, you know, and in some cases, they would pay the people that had those wind turbines. And depending on the kind of contract they had, others weren't paid. Okay? Now, let's see. Let me move. Oops. Now, this is a chart. Has anybody ever seen this one before? This is a fun one. You want to get this one on your phone, because it's fun to look at every now and then. But what this shows is Bonneville Power. This is a rolling 7 day. This is May this year. And what it shows is the power output from the various sources. And it also shows demand, or in other words, load. And this red line is load, okay? That's how much, you know, the lights are burning and all this kind of stuff. The blue line is hydropower. So you can see that we're running 12, 13, 14,000 megawatts of hydropower, and our load is pretty steady down here. Of course, it dips down at night at about 6,000 megawatts. So it's almost twice as much hydro being produced as we need. The green is wind, which we have some pretty good spikes every now and then. And then the red is fossil, and the purple is your friendly little nuclear power plant over here, Hanford. Now, you know, you've probably heard that the Snake River dams are used for peaking power, you know, for emergencies and stuff, and you guys are all in Tri-Cities. Now, this is in May of this year, and May is not as critical because of all the high flows, but this same thing happened. When the power plant, you see it dropped down to zero, that meant the plant went down. They won't tell us why, but it went down. And it stayed down for, I don't know how many days here, but last August, peak power time in eastern Washington, Hanford went off the grid for 2 weeks. Did you guys lose power? Did the lights go off in Tri-Cities? Because, you know, that's, and the reason I say that is because people constantly say, and if you lose the Snake River Dams, the lights are going to go out in Seattle, in Tri-Cities, or wherever. You're going to have brownouts and all this kind of stuff. It simply isn't the case. All you have to do is look at this chart, and you can see the massive amount of excess hydropower. So when they lost that, what you can see is the interchange dropped because they quit pushing some of it. They took 12,000 megawatts back from California and put it, you know, to you guys. But anyway, that's what's going on. Now, this gray line is the total amount of surplus. And so you can see 8,000 to 10,000 megawatts. And so that's what's being sometimes sold at, you know, I could look right now, it's probably going for $22 a megawatt hour, in other words, being lost. And you simply do the math there and say 8,000 megawatts times a loss of $10 a megawatt, and it doesn't take much to add up to some real losses. And when you're having to pay $10 an hour a megawatt, and then you know, that's like a $30 loss, and so, or $40 loss. So you can see that this stuff stacks up real quick. And that's why Bonneville has really burned through a lot of cash, because they got to keep paying people to go work on the dams and stuff, but they're losing money big time. And that's why they had to go back into the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission and ask for a surcharge. And that surcharge is going to be 2%. And it's funny, we got contracts, but these contracts are basically to buy the power. But we got to pay whatever rates they can justify to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. And they got a rule that says if their cash reserves get down to like 0 days or 10 days or 20 days, they can go to FERC and get a 2% surcharge popped on your bill pretty quickly. Now, whether your PUD, they'll get that bill, they'll get that power increase. Now, whether they pass it on to you as a customer this year or next year or somehow bury it in your base rate or something, it varies. So, and you know, all this information is just out there. It's government stuff. And basically, what we're trying to do is just present this information and let people understand what's really going on with the numbers and all this kind of stuff. The other problem that BPA has is their debt equals their assets. They're at 99% debt-to-asset ratio. And so, and that's by far the worst of any public utility in the country. And if this was your mortgage, they'd say you're basically underwater. I mentioned the cash reserves are pretty much gone. Customers are leaving. And one of the things that BPA is doing is cutting back on habitat funding. And they've already done this, $40 million back in January. And that's just habitat work going all over the place. Good stuff. But, you know, they're going to say, well, we're going to cut that first. And that's unfortunate because that habitat work really is good. It's really important. But on the other hand, no fish are getting back to it. It, you know, and Bonneville said this, it's a waste of money. So what is the solution for Bonneville? Is, you know, they've tried all kind of little cash, cost-cutting maneuvering, you know, bookkeeping drills. Let's cut back on travel. Let's cut back on conferences. Let's cut back on whatever. But that's not going to touch the kind of debt we're talking about. Their debt is $17 billion. That's a lot. The other thing that they're having a problem with is that about half that debt is from the U.S. Treasury, which they have to pay back in order to keep their borrowing authority intact. And that U.S. Treasury borrowing authority is their ticket out of jail because they can borrow money from the U.S. Treasury really easily. But they have to pay the interest. And they also have to pay that back on a pretty regular basis. But what they do to pay it back is they basically refinance their debt. So they pay Treasury $1 billion, and they'll borrow $950 million from some bond, you know, to get some bonds out there, some public debt or something like that. So they're really not reducing their debt, their true debt, their overall debt very much. And so that just keeps piling up. That's why their interest payments are so high. $45 million on a $200 million revenue stream I showed you a minute ago, that's pretty high. So they have to do something with their assets, and their assets are two things. Well, they only have one asset. That's a transmission system. But the other assets that the Corps of Engineers and Bureau of Reclamation bring to the party are the dams. And so if you're not looking at these dams in terms of what they cost and figuring out where do we put our money, which are the dams that really need the money and can bring us back the best return on investment, and which one are the losers? And so that's a key issue here, is are the government agencies actually doing that? And the answer is no. They haven't got to that point yet. We did it in 2002. We're trying to explain to the Corps of Engineers in Bonneville right now that you're in that situation. You never got out of it. And Snake River Dams, fortunately, unfortunately, I have no position on, you know, how you characterize that, but they're the ones that are the biggest issue in terms of cost and in terms of lost opportunity or benefits, and whether you're talking salmon or money. So speaking of fish, we were asked last night at the Salmon Recovery Board over in Dayton, you know, so how many fish actually return if you breach the dams? And various numbers have been floating around. Everybody thinks that the 2002 EIS actually developed some numbers, but it really didn't. What it did is it did studies to determine the relative returns between alternatives. And so basically what they said, let's start counting the returns in 1966 or 70. And that was after a lot of dams had already been built. And those numbers were then projected and compared with breaching and non-breaching. And so they could say, okay, we've got an increase with breaching, but the government folks, the Corps and BPA, said that looks too optimistic. Let's study it again. This time let's look at probability of extinction. Which one of these alternatives will keep salmon from going extinct? Well, like I said earlier, it's really difficult to totally extinct a salmon. You can probably do it with an orca or something like that, but it's difficult with these fish. And so what you saw was is the difference, in other words, the probability of extinction between not breaching and breaching was very small. Although breaching was more favorable, there wasn't much difference. And so it's kind of like, well, what's the big deal with breaching? Because it's only a marginal difference. Let's just keep the dams and improve them. But anyway, the next step of the process was to figure out what those fish were in a natural river. But they were using those really constrained low numbers to develop their economic output. It was like only $2 million worth of commercial fishing benefit with dam breaching. It's like, what? You know, we ought to be getting, historically, there was a lot of millions of fish going up that river. Granted, some of them were blocked by Hell's Canyon, that habitat there in Dorjak, but what's left is still about 60% of the original habitat that probably about 9 or 10 million fish were going up into that remaining habitat. So why do we have such small numbers? And so your guess, you know, if you want to do the backwards math in terms of historic runs, eliminate habitat, you'll probably come up with a better answer than what's in these reports. So what does it cost to get the river back to a natural condition? Well, of course, the first thing you have to do is breach the dam. And that was originally estimated in 2000, about $870 million. We've gone back in with some guys inside Walla Walla and myself and figured out, found lots of errors in the cost, and we've got that in those year dollars down to $240 million. And it's about $340 million in today's dollars. So there was a $600 million mistake in the cost estimate for breaching. And by the way, that cost estimate was just to remove the earthen berm. I think I have a picture here. Okay, so this is what the Corps said. This is the way you breach. You remove the earthen berm, the upper two dams. The lower dams, as you folks know, they don't have big earthen berms, so you have to dig out some of the earthen abutment, but basically, that's a lot cheaper. The Corps also estimated removing the entire concrete. That was in the $2 to $3 billion range, and it was unnecessary. So when you hear people talking about dam removal, and there's still a lot of environmental groups that say, oh, we've got to take the whole thing out, no, you don't. That's a waste of money and not necessary. So let me get back to where I was. So breaching, including some mitigation for some railroad stuff and a little bit of irrigation, maybe about $400 million would get mitigation in, but it's certainly not $1 or $2 billion. And for you folks in Washington State, that's not a bill that the state of Washington pays, even though Governor Inslee keeps telling everybody that he's got to pay $1 billion to breach these dams, and that's wrong. But we can't get anybody in there to tell him the right answer. Like I said, the benefit-cost ratio is 4-1, but it could be much higher because we don't need to replace all that surplus power I showed you, or that EPA is actually showing you on those charts. And you also got to keep in mind that solar is just really coming online big time. And part of that problem, the reason the price is dropping on that surplus power, because Bonneville actually used to make money off of that until about 5 years ago. But our friends down in California got serious with solar, and they put 9,000 megawatts of solar into the system in the last 6 years. And they're still piling it on. BPA has this thing called the integration queue, which is people waiting to put power onto their transmission system. There's 2,000 megawatts of solar in Washington, in Oregon, in Idaho, mostly Washington, Oregon, that they want to put on the grid. It's penciling out. That when people want to put it on the grid, that means they're ready to go, they're ready to build their solar or whatever it is and stick it into the grid. Wind, same thing, several thousand megawatts still out there, people trying to get on the grid. And the reason is it just really, wind now is certainly Chief Joseph. Those are big dams, high hip, you know, a lot of, you know, efficiency there. But they're certainly cheaper than like Snake River dams and maybe even some of the other ones. The other thing that's happening with breaching is you save money that, you, as I mentioned, you can put it on higher value dams and other restoration needs. You know, when the Corps does their budget, you know, it's kind of like, this is much for transportation, here's hydropower, here's flood control, here's environmental. Well, nearly all the environmental money has been going to the Snake River dams for the last 10 or 15, 20 years. And so projects elsewhere in the state are being unfunded, like the Puget Sound Nearshore Restoration, $400 million, no money for it. Breaching also puts at least 3,000 or 4,000 more jobs in the state, either both recreation jobs associated with boating and all that kind of stuff, and hiking, and also fishing. And then there's also an additional 1,000 or so that when you breach the dams, you open up 40,000 acres. 20,000 of that is under the water right now. That used to be, a lot of it used to be orchards, vineyards for wine. Original viticulture part of Washington was there. And we had an economist look at that, and he said that if we put not all of it, but about a third of it back into agriculture, that generates another couple $100 million in direct economic and benefits along 140 miles. Okay, so picture there, if you will, orchards back there, vineyards, what goes along with vineyards, wineries. You keep building, what do you got? You got restaurants, you got inns, you got a whole little, you know, wine valley put back into the Lower Snake. A lot of economic value. And then, of course, you shift funding from the waterborne, the transportation stuff, to other needs in the state of Washington. This is sort of a more direct, if you will, set of expenditures that you get from recreation benefits in the counties along the river. And these are your neighbors to the east. And you can see this is not small change. And even though you'd say, wow, that, you know, can it really be that much? Well, even if it was half that much, that's still a lot of money. You know, worth at least a couple $100 million, 200, 300, 400. And so so let's just say we cut it in half. That is still a ton of money going into these four counties. Here are the number of jobs that are produced. Say you don't think those are high, cut it in half. That's still a lot of jobs out there, folks. So, now, talk about the cost and economics and so forth like that, and fish a little bit. So, what are the policies and what are the constraints about actually getting breaching done? I'm sure everybody's heard that the Corps of Engineers has to have congressional legislation or authority to breach the dams, right? Everybody hear that? No, you do not. The reason is because when the Corps has a project, it's not economically viable or it's endangering species or something like that. So we got two of those going on right now with these dams. The Corps has a fiduciary responsibility under laws given to them by Congress for the last 200 years. It basically says, you got to take care of the project. And so what the Corps does is they put it into a caretaker or non-operational status. There's an example down in Portland with the Willamette Lock and Dam. And the district commander basically decided, all right, we cannot afford to operate this baby anymore. So they did some work on the spillway to let the water go through. They put the locks on the lock so everybody could go through. And it's just sitting there. It's non-operational. And so when you do that with 100 foot of course, you can't just walk away from a dam with 100 feet of water behind it and think, well, let's just pop, you know, go over the spillway indefinitely. For two reasons. Once it'll erode the spillway, the dam will start falling apart. The other one, you get too much spill. And I should have mentioned, you know, no one asked me, well, maybe you wouldn't want to ask, let you ask questions, but on this surplus hydro, why do we keep generating it if we're losing money? You guys know the answer to that? Problem is that too much spill over the spillway creates what in the river?
Nitrogen, too much
dissolved gas, supersaturation gas, yeah. And if If it, so what the dams are doing right now is they are spilling right up to the what they call the gas cap, which is set by law, I don't know, 120 or whatever it is. And we're up at 125, and you can check the charts at 135, and sometimes it, you know, it's running up and down like this, because this is not like fine-tuning your, you know, the speed of your car. This is these big machines, man. And so as you're trying to get the spill just right to keep exceeding that gas cap, you lose it, kill a bunch of fish. And so you can't just spill water and turn turbines off because you can't sell the power. The only way you can not generate power in our hydro system with run-of-river dams, not Grand Coulee or Chief Joe, but the run-of-river dams, you just got to take them out of service. Okay? There isn't any other way to beat the hydraulics on this thing. So, the other thing is, you say, okay, one of the things you need to breach a dam is a NEPA document. Well, we have one. Right here, 2002. The previous Secretary of the Army even wrote me a letter and affirmed that the core policy is that is the EIS to control this project. Okay, and so I'm getting the signal to speed up, so I'll try to do that. So anyway, we have an EIS. It's ready to go. You can implement breaching right with that. In this is the breach plan of the EIS. It's in there. It's all covered. The other thing is that's going on is this court case that you guys have heard about, the federal biological opinion, and that the courts have ordered the Corps of Engineers and Bonneville and all these agencies to study this thing for another 5 years and come up with a new EIS for not only Snake Dams, but all the dams in the federal system, 17 dams. Well, I won't get into the problem with that, but the point here is that does not constrain the Corps of Engineers from breaching these dams today. Okay? And that's there are a lot of lawyers in the Corps. Bonneville will keep telling everybody, oh no, we can't do anything until we do this long study. Wrong. That biop has been going on for a long time, and what this chart just simply shows you is that the left side is sort of the policy steps that this has been going through since 1991, when we started our first systems operations reviews, and we ended up with this 2002 EIS there. And then in the meantime, in 2000, the environmental folks started suing on the biological opinion. They don't call them opinions for nothing. It feeds into this EIS. This EIS is dated 2002. They started suing on a 2000 biop. It's, okay, so they did that. Maybe it was a good strategy, but they've sued now 5 times. They did a great job. They won 5 times. The problem is, the dams are still there, and we haven't made